So much of what we talked about this morning, we really have focused about how much the decade of centenaries is about the present day. And I'm sure in the talks that you've all been to through the last few years, you know, we continually look back on how much what we do as commemoration is about what we want to achieve today and what we want to achieve in the future. So it's not just about history of what happened a century ago, it's about what we want to do with that history today and what we want to do with it in the future. And so much of that is shaped by contemporary politics as well. So what we're hearing in the news, what we're observing, the political conversations we're having with our friends will shape how we interpret a century ago. And the same happens in what you might call memory politics and how we perform collective remembering of the past through things like commemoration, through rituals, through anniversaries, through monuments, and through museums. So in this presentation, I'm just going to talk about a couple of objects that I think are very thoughtful objects and can trigger a lot of those sorts of conversations. The first object is one that was brought to a Living Legacies workshop, and the Living Legacies is a First World War engagement and research centre. And we've had numerous workshops with people over the years. And to one of these workshops, a Chinese plait, as in a plait of hair, was brought to that workshop. So I'm going to talk about it. And then the second object I'm going to talk about is a collection of autographs, a little book of autographs. And what I feel about both of these objects is there's still a history about them that is relatively untouched, that we really need to tease out a little bit more. And these are objects that, depending how you deal with them, can be quite hot objects and show quite a contested history. So whenever we put anything on a public display, we are assuming an object, an audience, and that is the imagined community. So when we put things on display, we're imagining who's going to come in and who's going to see it. And we create an opportunity for exchange. And that's exchange between the viewer and the object, and the exchange between others that are sharing that space with us. And that change, exchange, can trigger a lot of memories, it can create connections, and it can forge momentum. And objects, texts, images, rituals, these are all ways that memory gets organised and reproduced. And what I've also found is through a lot of preservation of objects, the creation of monuments, we come obliged to our memory. As soon as you create a ritual, as soon as you create a tradition, it's something that we have to maintain. And that point really struck me one day when I was in Bray. I don't know if any of you have been to Bray. And if you walk along, this is outside Dublin, if you walk along the seafront, there's many benches all inscribed with names of who's died. And these aren't to do with the centenary, these are recent people who've died. And the families have put this bench at the seafront for you to sit down on the bench and read the inscription. And this to me, you know, it's very striking that not only do the family members want themselves to sit down and remember, they want other people to do it too. They want people who, I don't know that person, but they want me to stop and look and read the inscription. Why would a private family member want to bring others into that circle of remembrance when I have no contact with that person at all? So there seems to be that sort of idea of wanting to draw people in, wanting everybody else to remember with you, even if you didn't know that person. And it's a very deliberate act of changing the cultural landscape. My mother-in-law joked that, you know, it's actually quite a depressing walk, the seafront, because you just get reminded, you know, step by step of this long list of people who have passed away. But there is this idea of an obligation to remember. We're being reminded that we should be remembering all the time. The other element of this sort of objectification of memory is that it becomes the heritage of society. It becomes our officially sanctioned heritage as a result. So the way these objects are used, the way we create sort of value and meaning in these public spaces is very much tied to the present day identities and what we want to achieve. And the same can be said of the memory of war and conflict. and how we use objects to maintain bonds. And this is as much to create a bond with the deceased as it is to create a bond with the with other people. And it's also, in a way, to sort of keep mourning alive. You know, this continuously remembering, we are continually mourning as well. And this also becomes an idea of collective remembrance, that we're doing this with other people, and it is opportunities then to sort of sit down on the bench with me and I will tell you about somebody. So there is a real process, there's a real ritual in remembering, and these objects become points of memory, and the same can be said if you visit our museums here in the city. There are certain objects that really make things real, really bring things home. And there's a quote that I use in the literature often, that these objects can prick and wound and grab and puncture. So there are objects in our museum collections that are quite contested or quite hot and can really become triggers, and sometimes quite painful triggers for these sort of stories. So the object, some of you may have seen this exhibition, Remembering 1916, in the Ulster Museum. It was on at the same time of the exhibition we heard about from the Nerve Centre. And this was mostly a lot of objects that were brought to Living Legacies workshops over the preceding years. But there's one, and this is quite a traditional exhibition, quite different to what we've heard about already today. But here, there's an object that I want to talk about, is this. Now, it's quite hard to see, and I'm on another slide of it. This plait of hair. And it was Chinese person's hair that was cut off. And I'll read the label for you. I've got another slide close up of the label. Private waters witnessing this queue being cut from a man serving with the Chinese Labour Corps. Following an agreement between the Chinese and British governments in 1916, thousands of Chinese workers were recruited to fill the labour shortage. So that label is quite an underestimate of the story that could have been told with this plait. And I think that plait is an example of how we can dig much deeper with the stories of the First World War period. Although the First World War is very much a story of Protestant and Catholics, Unionists and Nationalists, that's the story it is for this island. But what about all the other folk who have come to live on this island, who also have connections to the First World War, whose families, who are also descendants from people who contributed, and whose countries changed massively as a result of the First World War. So I think there still is a little bit of potential there for that story to be told. And I really feel it is a story that will resonate with migrant communities in Northern Ireland. And this one is an example of that for me. David Waters, who he joined up, he enlisted as a private in the 36th Ulster Division in 1914. By 1916, he was promoted to the rank of sergeant, and then he transferred to the Chinese Labour Corps, where he served as an officer. And it was during this time that he retrieved this plait, and the story that was told in his family was that this plait was removed from a Chinese person as a disciplinary act. So somehow this Chinese person did something and they took the plait of hair. What would that have meant to that person to have his plait of hair removed? So and some of you may, who have a very good knowledge of the period, may already know a fair bit about the Chinese contribution. But they contributed by working for the British and French war effort, and recruitment began in 1916, and they worked in factories, railways and docks. Some had to clear forests and others to remove ammunition from the battlefield sites. So when they signed up to the Chinese Labour Corps, this is what they were told, and I'm reading from another source, and it might resonate a little bit with the hope some people had when they joined up from here. The British and French guaranteed that any man who was willing to join the war effort would be well looked after. The workers would be paid, and it was promised that a percentage of each man's wages would be sent back to his family at home. So that was the motivation for them joining the Labour Corps. However, Matthew Leonard, an archaeologist who works on a First World War battlefield and sites, describes the traumas of the journey from the Chinese ports to Europe. Men may have spent months in the bowels of ships with little opportunity to get above board or even off the ship when it was in various ports along the way. There were a lot of people in those ships who didn't really know what was going on as a result. He writes, and this is a quote from Leonard, "Many of the workers had never left their villages, let alone their country, and the experience of joining the apparatus of an industrial war must have been overwhelming." He writes of the drowning of some 543 Chinese when a French transport ship was sunk in 1917, before their recruitment records were taken. So this ship sank and they didn't know who was on it. So you had 550 men sunk and they didn't even know the names. So this plot, for me, is very emotionally affecting object, and you can imagine the impact it would have on some people in some communities working with it. In a way, I feel, now it's a private object, it belongs to the family, but I feel there is potential here to sort of dig deeper to tease out these stories. And I'm, you know, what story would we want to tell with this object if we were doing workshops with communities, whether it's with our own or, you know, with migrant communities, or with established Chinese communities in this region. And that this is where I think that there is great potential. And this is a memorial that I've taken from Matthew Leonard's, from material he has online, which is a memorial to that ship that was sunk. There has been some remembrance work done around it. So the next object I want to talk to you about, and this is a project that I was involved with in Fermanagh County Museum, that also involved the Derry Heritage Museum Service. And this is a project from quite a number of years ago now, and it was to do with the early 20th century, and Fermanagh County Museum and the museum up here recognised that they really didn't have a lot of artefacts in their collection to do with the early 20th century. This is one of the objects that came through, and it was a macrame bag to do with the Argenta prison ship. And we displayed the artefact I want to talk about in more detail, which is this autograph book, in an exhibition in, I think it was 2012. And I didn't really think enough back then about it, that we really did not dig deep enough with the stories that could be told with this autograph book. So this book, it's a fragment of a really important story for this island. And it's an autograph book that is fairly, like, whenever you're doing a museum exhibition, you know, you love having really striking objects. This is not a visibly striking object. If this was put on display, no matter how good the story was, if it was put on display in a crowded exhibition, you'd walk straight past. You would not really barely glance at the autograph book. So since I started doing a little bit more research on the Argenta, I found that it really does sort of reside in the shadows of our histories. And what the Argenta prison ship was moored on the Belfast and Larne locks between 1922 and 1924. So this is a future centenary that we're looking towards. And it held up to 700 men in prison because they were thought to be a threat to the new state. So this autograph book was compiled by Ted Brady and was purchased by Fermanagh County Museum, as I said, in 2011. And it was quite a departure for the collection. It really added a dimension that wasn't covered. And if you imagine Fermanagh County Museum, this is a museum that would be known for its folklife collection, for some of its archaeological collection, for its artworks. So this is quite a departure. So what I found is, in that turbulent early 20th century, when there's so much painful and divisive histories, that the legacy of the Argenta does not seem to be common knowledge, and you can disagree with me if you feel that it is. So in conversations with friends of mine brought up in nationalist homes, they weren't aware of the Argenta until I mentioned it to them. And then going through Anne Pavlik, the Republican news. There's very few mentions of the Argenta prison ship. But I did come across one mention, and this was in 2001 when the Canadian woman Denise Klein Rickard published a book on Argenta, and she herself was a descendant of an internee on the ship. And the book was recommended for the New Year shopping list. And Poblack referred to the Argenta as a largely sidelined aspect of Irish history. And in writing the book, Denise has, this is their words, Denise has done a great service in bringing to life again the lives of those held in below deck cages on this prison ship moored during the years in Belfast Lock. So the Argenta was brought into use in 1922 when, after the introduction of the Civil Authorities Special Powers Act, increasing numbers of nationalists were interred. The Argenta was a wooden steamer built for the US Shipping Board to be operated as an emergency vessel during the Great War after being condemned as unseaworthy. It was purchased in May 1922 by the military advisor of the Northern Ireland government. It was then refitted by Harland and Wolff workers and inspected by Sir Dawson Bates, Minister for Home Affairs, and thought ready for first prisoners within a month of arriving at Belfast. And it was used for that purpose until early 1924, when it was decommissioned, and then in Klein Rickard's words, as if to erase all memory, the ship was literally carted off a scrap. So do many of you know about the Argenta already?
Yeah. So I remember the book coming out. It was very popular at the time because I'd never heard it until then. Yeah. And then we had a lot of people looking.
Yeah. And you're aware of the Argenta story?
I came across it.
Quite horrific. So whenever the ship was pulled apart and carted off as scrap, or Denise Klein Rickard talks about what happened, different elements of the ship, and how a church pastor bought the wooden ship, broke it up and sold it as firewood. She also tells the story of Dawson Bates, I think it was him, cooking his breakfast over the dying embers of the ship, so very evocative. I don't know how much of that is true, but that bit anyway. She talks about the Argenta Bell, which still survives, that was run daily on the prison ship, was bought by the Minister of Home Affairs for £15 and displayed in his home. She records, it hung in a place of family honour with a wooden frame flanked on either side by two wooden warder's battens. Why would you display that in your home? Klein Rickard, who visited the Bell in the home of a descendant of Dawson Bates, described her reaction to hearing its sound. Clang, clear, distinct, resonant. After 76 years, I heard the tone of the Argenta Bell, polished, a family heirloom, passed to a successive generation. Its significance meant peace to some. Its presence brought me to my grandfather again. He heard its inflection each day for 18 months. I heard its voice, an echo of the years past. So this artifact brought her straight back to the grandfather she never met. And she felt she was with him, just hearing the bell. So it's that idea of objects being so affecting to have that impact on people. So she had a very, very emotional reaction to the object. But what I'm looking at this autograph book, you know, you can go through this autograph book. I have a photograph of every page, but I've only got the one up here. You can go through this book and you can find the names of all those people who were on the prison boat. You could research what happened to them. In Denise's book, she says how long they were on hunger strike, for example, while on the ship. So there's a lot of research that can be done with an object like this. But, you know, we didn't do that work in that project, but it doesn't mean it's not something that can still be done. But it's only a project that you could do with a lot of sensitivity, with a lot of thoughtfulness. The framework that we were talking about this morning would be something that would have to be brought into play with something like this. And certainly that engagement work that we've talked about already today is also something that would have to underpin a project like this. But in a way, as we look forward to the future years of the decade, I do wonder, are there objects that are almost fearful objects that almost have nearly too much, or too painful to really engage with, and could this be an example of one? And I came across the idea of the fearful object in my reading, and I was in a book by Sherry Turkle called Falling for Science, and in it she writes about the Jewish scientist Oliver Sacks, who was moved out of London during the Second World War, and he had nightmares post the Second World War. And in one of them he talked about when he saw mercury coming into contact with aluminium, and he saw the chemical reaction of that, and he saw it, the aluminium dissolving and the fungus that was growing as the chemicals acted on the metal. He said, until the aluminium was completely eaten up, it made me think of a curse or a spell, the sort of disintegration I sometimes saw in my dreams. And Turkle reflects that the stresses of the war period took its toll on Sacks. The rotting away of the aluminium evokes the death and carnage of war, the cancer of fascism and anti-Semitism. So mercury in contact with aluminium was, in Turkle's words, the fearful object which brought Sacks in contact with his worst fears. So it's this idea that there is still a fear, you know, a fear that can persist. So I find her term, the fearful object, quite captivating, and I wonder, can it be applied to the material culture in our collections at home or in our museums that we think are nearly too hot to handle? And I think the fearful object goes beyond dark material culture. It goes beyond things of dark tourism, beyond what some people would call the sort of voyeuristic pleasure people get in visiting sites of dark tourism. And I also think the fearful object might go beyond objects that we might find repulsive or difficult to come to terms with. So I was in Poland for a week recently in the Jewish Museum there, and there's a lot in there that is, you know, that we, a lot of histories in there and a lot of artifacts that you would find quite difficult to come to terms with. And the other example that I saw at a conference last year was items out of the Royal College of Surgeons collection, which included stomach pumps. The archivist from the collection came to the conference with a whole host of objects that she laid out on the table for us to look at, to do with force-feeding people. And it wasn't just hunger, when we think of the hunger strikers, we think of political men and political, but also suffragettes. So she had lots of images of that. And it really, you just look at these objects and they make your blood run cold. But what I'm thinking about with the fearful object are objects that might still extend a threat today. So there's objects that we know are very dark objects, and we all agree and we all respond in the same way to those objects. But what about those fearful objects that we might respond differently to? And that is where the threat is, potentially, is when our responses aren't shared, but they are quite different responses. So I feel that certainly the way we displayed the Argenta prison book in the past was probably quite different to the way we would do it now. But I think it really was inclusion without engagement. We included the object, but we didn't really engage with it. And I think the learning that we talked about this morning that we've had in the time since would make us more equipped to deal with an artifact like this. So I would suggest that there is still examples, and it all just depends on how you react. So I think there are still examples of individual and collective resistance to deep exploration of the material culture that can be used as evidence of practices that today we might find abhorrent and possibly even shameful. And looking back at the Chinese queue and the Argenta autograph book, these are periods and these are objects and these are experiences that are difficult to engage with, whether privately or also in our national or local authority museums. We can touch on the period, we can include the objects, but only in such a way that we barely glance at some of them. Megan Bowler, writing about the interpretation of the Holocaust, describes such presentations as easy reading and accounts that provide an abdication of responsibility, leading to a voyeuristic pleasure of listening and judging the other from a position of power or safe distance. And I think there is a certain amount of that sort of safe. There are some people who don't have any distance and aren't safe, and there are others who are, who look in. And that sort of struck me, and I don't know if any of you were involved in the wave, Stories from Silence. Mm-hmm. And I sat at home listening to the Stories from Silence. They're small, like 2 minute clips. And you know, it felt very uncomfortable for me to be sitting at home listening to their pain. I don't know if anybody else, you know, and I was trying to address my own response and my own relationship of listening to those stories. So how should we respond to this in our situation as we include objects without truly investigating the complexity of the histories? Can we accuse ourselves of inclusion without engagement? And certainly the number of workshops that you were talking about earlier, it shows us that there's a lot of engagement going on there, but it also demonstrates with these few objects there's potential for more. And I hope maybe you can give me some ideas about that. So returning to the point at the beginning of this talk, memory work is more about the present day than it is about the past. When tackling the display of such histories and the material culture that is a tangible evidence, there are many layers of consideration. From the nature of the institution doing the interpretation, the people engaged in the process, and the social and political geography of the place it is located. How deep do we want to dig with things like this? Given the social and political context of where we are, perhaps there is a risk with engagement, because of the fragile nature of the peace process in Northern Ireland, there is a fear that if we aren't careful, we can cause further division. So you can't do these things with any form of without that thoughtfulness that you were talking about earlier with ethical shared remembering. So there is a fear associated with revealing injustice or evidence of cruelty or brutality, and that continues with the recent troubles as much as it would from a century ago. There are those in the literature that are still talking about pasts that are unsayable. That's still a term that is used. And these are referred to as histories that are beyond the usual modes of public reconciliation. So there is still difficult knowledge that is brushed, swept under the carpet. And there are colleagues of mine have talked about, now this is talking about more globally, they're not referring to Northern Ireland. He said, we are the reluctant publics which must be forced to confront horrific realities in which we may be somehow complicit. So, you know, sometimes we do have to look as much as ourselves as what others have done. So, as well as other locations, this risk is managed within national cultural institutions. In public spaces, our interpretation of the past is deliberately chosen. It is a past that takes account more generally of the purposefulness of remembrance in public spaces, and specifically of the importance of our cultural institutions as places of authority and influence, and even of safety, that we can actually, in a very shared approach, discuss objects like this. So the creativity and change we've seen during the decade already, and I would say evident here in Derry last week, shows that we live in a time of great possibility. And this process is already and will continue to be driven by innovative people prepared to turn reflection on our fearful pasts into pioneering practice and change.